Good afternoon, Facebook Live. This is Robin Kirby-Gatto. Welcome to today. It is going to be an awesome day in the Lord. Are you super excited? Because I am. Why? This is the day of the beginning of the Galatians 2:20 fast. So as you join on here, saints of God, you be hopeful and expected that Holy Spirit is going to encourage you. God is going to edify you in truth. And oh my goodness, we are going to be so full and satisfied. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, Priscilla Westover, so good to see you on here. God bless you. It is awesome to have this new iPad. Hey, Steve, God bless you, brother. It was so good to have this new iPad from Joanne Morgan. Oh my goodness. It absolutely makes my life so super easy now compared to the other iPad that I had. And you know what's interesting is that it speaks to seasons that you and I are going through. Hey, Samantha, God bless you. I love you. Hope to see you in South Carolina. Hey, Kathy Forbes, I hope to see you in South Carolina. I will actually be ministering in South Carolina the third weekend of August. Show up if you're able. I'll be close to the Columbia area. Hey, Mary Holt, God bless you. So good to see you, sister. And as you join on here, saints of God, oh my goodness, be expectant. Holy Spirit is going to bring you such exhortation of truth, amen. Hey, Dee, God bless you. So good to see you. So as we enter today's message, I'm going to begin in prayer, amen. God, we thank you for the power of Holy Spirit. We thank you, God, that you are able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that we can think or imagine, according to the power that is at operation inside of us. And God, we thank you for your word because it offers us truth. It brings us your admonishment and exhortation to keep us in the narrow way. And God, as we enter this fast, as we enter into a time of searching our hearts and humbling ourselves, we ask you, God, to cause us to have your eyes, righteousness, amen, righteous eyes and righteous hearing, where we do not judge by our own seeing or our own hearing, but with righteousness, hallelujah, we distribute equity of who you are in the righteousness of Christ Jesus, which is how you wage war, hallelujah, and cause us to wage war with the enemy. In Jesus' name, amen. I see Dinya. God bless you, Dinya. So good to see you on here. I see a few more people joining in. Hey, Elizabeth, God bless you. Hey, Eva, I love you. So good to see you, sister. Hey, James, God bless you. Hey, Sue Gailey, I love you. So awesome to have y'all on here. So let us look at this fast. What is it? Whenever God calls me to a fast, there's a special grace which equals commitment. When you're thinking about grace, you think about your commitment. And so as we look at this fast, don't do necessarily what I'm doing, which is that I fast my lunchtime meal and I'll be fasting into dinner. So Monday through Friday, I'm doing this fast. And he always gives me a scripture when I do a fast. And for this particular fast, God said, Robin, I want you to do a Galatians 2:20 fast. God woke me up in the night about a week ago. And he said, I want you to do a Galatians 2:20 fast. And we're going to get into that depiction today. And I'm going to get into scripture. And God is going to give us wisdom from above, liberally, because we're going to ask him, and he's going to lead us in the narrow way. Amen. So let's look at Galatians 2:20. I'm reading out the Amplified, and this is the fast that God is bringing us into. We know that a fast generally depicts itself as us humbling ourselves, and I've actually done a teaching about fasting, as well as done a teaching about the true fast and what a true fast is, as in represented in Isaiah. What is going to be amazing is that this fast has a special thing for you and I, where we are going to be more crucified with Christ Jesus. I mean, I feel a hair on my neck. We're going to be more crucified with Christ, which means what? Our carnal nature, amen, is going to decrease, and we, by the Holy Spirit, are going to be yielded in such fruit in this hour of the greater works of excellent fruit where Jesus Christ in us increases. Amen. How many of you want to decrease, that you want your carnal nature to just decrease in you? I do, amen. I hope you do. I know you do if you're on this broadcast. And how many of you want Jesus Christ in you, the hope of glory, to increase? Amen. We are the salt and light of the earth. When people see us, they should see Christ Jesus. And I will have, it just reminds me, Rev 22.2 will be out on Amazon next week. It's up for pre-order on Kindle. And so I'm on a mad dash to get it edited because it's locked in on Friday. And I cannot do any more editing after that. It will be out next week. And one of the emphasis that this book has really had in my life, it has absolutely, totally wrecked me in a way that I cannot even put words to. And it has just made me, the best depiction I could tell you, is more sensitive to the Spirit. Sensitive to the Spirit. To the voice of God. I love God's voice. It is my aim. Whenever I preach the word, whenever I teach, whenever I post on Facebook Live, my aim is to hear the voice of God, that still small voice of God. When I prophesy by the Spirit of God, in the spirit of prophecy, as well as the gift of prophecy, my aim is to hear accurately the voice of God. And that book that I'm writing now, it has made me even more sensitive to the Spirit and more sensitive to the voice of God. And so in this fast, Galatians 2:20, this is a depiction, is a great depiction of what God is going to do in our life. He is going to make us more sensitive to His Spirit. And He's going to make us more sensitive, amen, to the ability of confidence that we have in hearing His voice. He had to do this to the prophet Elijah. I get in detail about that actually in my book, At His Feet, in chapter 7 about God's name, Jealous. A lot of people do not realize this increase and decrease that actually occurs in Elijah. And so we're going to start in Galatians 2:20 today, and then we're going to go to 1 Kings 19. Amen, D. D is actually reading about it today. And we're going, and I was actually talking about it yesterday with someone else. But we're going to be looking at this because it is the best picture. It is the best visual, the best analogy in order for you to understand this process. I'm doing it the entire month of June. Of course, I'm taking off the 14th because actually Rich and I will be having a rest day that day, fellowshipping with one another. But other than that, Monday through Friday, I'm doing one meal a day, and it's going to be for me lunch. If God leads you to do it, join in, whatever He leads you to do. Let's start in Galatians 2:20, amen. Well, in fact, let's actually start in verse 19. Verse 19, and we'll springboard into verse 20, amen. For I through the law, under the operation of the curse of the law, have in Christ's death for me, myself died to the law. Hear that, saints of God. Hear that, saints of God. Because I get into it in Revelation 22, and I actually get into the science of it and break it down as God has totally led me like none other. And I show you exactly what happened when Adam and Eve ate of the fruit and their eyes were open, because a transaction happened, because we know that Adam and Eve did not die a natural death in that very moment of eating the fruit, but God was rather depicting a spiritual death that would result from eating the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And something specifically happened that changed everything to Adam. about God. And this is what Paul is emphasizing, what happens when we decrease. I'm sorry, I keep feeling a hair, like one of my hairs that have fallen out of my neck. And as Paul depicts this, he's bringing the emphasis that, look, since Christ has come, since I am in Christ, things have been redeemed, where now my depiction of God, my ability to see and to hear God, is under the covering and banner of love. Song of Solomon 2:4. When Adam and Eve's eyes were opened by eating the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, what happened was their depiction of how they perceived God was totally distorted. Hey, Terry, I love you. It was totally distorted. God had not changed. He remained the same and remains the same today. He does not change. He's not a man that he has to repent. He doesn't have to change his mind. He is God Almighty. Amen. He doesn't change his mind. He is God. And so if God didn't change, then who changed? Adam and Eve. And why? Because they ate of the forbidden tree, and it added chaos unto them, which brought confusion, vexation of the thorns, vexation and curse of bearing a child in pain. And all of that was representative of the change that occurred in man. So who does the change have to occur in, as revealed in Scripture? Jesus showed us, as we are born from above, we are born of the Spirit. We partake in that new birth, and that is that indication of the abundant life that Jesus Christ came to bring me. And this is what is absolutely amazing, because as we look at this, we also get revelation that when we are walking in fellowship with Christ Jesus, the means by which the enemy is going to attack our mind is going to be through vexation, chaos, and pride. He does not change. It's the same tactics. In order to change our perception of how we perceive God, it would be like me coming home to our house, and when I came to my house and walked in the door, and Matthew was coming out of the bedroom, and he heard me coming home, I would not change. I'd be happy. I'm like, woo, I'm home. I'm happy to see you. So good to see you, Matthew. But if Matthew's perception about me had changed, and he saw me as coming in and being in a place where he dreaded my arrival, he dreaded my voice, it's not because I would have changed, but it's because he would have changed. That's exactly what happened with Adam and Eve. God didn't change, but their perception changed because their eyes had been open to good and evil, to blessing and calamity. Let me tell you, whatever you give your attention to, whatever you're studying, it's going to be added unto you. We were never created to study darkness. We were always created to study the light, truth. Now, will God expose the enemy's plans? Will he show them to us? Absolutely. Hallelujah. He gives us wisdom. He gives us understanding. And he gives us his strategy, his direction. And we walk in that pathway. But what I have seen is that there are so many people majoring on studying darkness. And this is a deception, saints of God, because what we are to study is the goodness of God and to know him as Jesus has revealed him and interpreted him to us as Father. That sonship relationship brings a deeper hunger and thirst for intimacy through friendship. Amen. So let's look at Galatians 2:20 And let's begin this fast with such a rich teaching that it is going to leave us just overwhelmed with love. Amen. Galatians 2, verse 19 again, and then I'm going to get into the main verse, verse 20, and then we'll go into 1 Kings 19. For I, through the law, under the operation of the curse of the law, have in Christ's death, do you hear this? In Christ's crucifixion, I have in Christ's death for me, myself died to the law. Do you see when Adam's ears were opened and his eyes were opened, as well as Eve, to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, God's love then did not sound like love to Adam, but instead it sounded like fear, dread, and punishment, which is why there was the law to direct us and make us conscious of sin so that we would not give ourselves over to sin. And so God brought the law through Moses, and Jesus fulfilled the law as he was baptized in Matthew 3, that baptism unto fulfill all righteousness. For Jesus' baptism in Matthew 3 was a baptism that only he could undergo, and that baptism was a baptism to fulfill all righteousness. So in that moment, Jesus demonstrated, as even the Father opened the heavens and sent forth Holy Spirit like a dove, landing upon Jesus, and God said, this is my what? Son, the title name he gave Jesus. This is my Son in whom I am well pleased. In that one moment, the fulfillment of the law was brought into manifestation as the chapter began to open when Jesus underwent that baptism. That was the first entry point to fulfill all righteousness that would end and be solidified by his blood that would be shed on a cross. And so we have to comprehend this. 1 John 4:18 is very clear that perfect love does what? Drives out fear. It drives it out. And where there's perfect love, and that word perfect is teleos, it means maturity, it means completeness, it means being made whole, and it indicates a growth, an even intellect growth, that we are mature in some way. And so that love brings perfection, right? And it says in that love, there is no fear, there is no dread of punishment, right? So when we see fear, when we see dread of punishment operative within our members, in our hearts, in our mind, and that composes your soul. Your soul is composed of your heart and your mind. But don't forget your second brain. It's in your belly. So your heart is your brain one, brain two in your belly, and your heart, brain one and brain two. That's your soul. That's your soul, your heart, brain one and brain two. And so your soul is being ministered to by Holy Spirit translating the word to your spirit man, growing you strong in spirit, which then, by God's grace, brings it to your soul in your belly, in your second brain, and it brings it up from there to your heart, and then to the mind, which gives you what? The renewed mind. That is when the Logos has been sown in your belly. In your spirit is bringing that translation from Holy Spirit, and that Logos word turns into a sword. It turns into the sword of the Spirit. It turns into Rhema, and that is your weapon. That's what the devil's afraid of. But listen, saints, as you become more crucified with Christ Jesus, what we see in verse 19 is it's indicating that we are dead to the law. Now, how do we know that we're dead to the law? Because Scripture says that when we walk in love, that's what scripture says, when we are in love, that love fulfills the law. Why? Because who is love? God. God is love. So when you and I are walking in the Spirit, when we are walking in love, that is because we have decreased and Christ Jesus has increased in us. And that love, hallelujah, of Christ, it fulfills the law. It's finished. It's done. And we have grace. So if we have fear, if we have dread, if we have the thought of punishment, if we have vexation where we're looking at God as one that is going to bring us under a whip, that is a flag. It's a trigger to let you know that there is somewhere in your soul, when we're talking about strongholds, that is going to be in this area up here, generally in your subconscious, that is going to have root systems of thorns of the enemy that are coming against your mind and continually lying about who the Father is. And that's where fear, that's where dread of punishment comes in. And so we see with Christ Jesus that when we are crucified with Him, guess what we get? Hallelujah. More love. Walking in the Spirit. Wholeness and healing. Hallelujah. So let's look again at verse 19. And we're finally going to get to verse 20. Amen. For I, through the law, under the operation of the curse of the law, have in Christ death for me. Myself, I have died to the law. Do you hear that, saints of God? And all the law's demands upon me, so that I may henceforth, do you hear this, saints of God? I may henceforth live to and for God. Amen. Amen, everyone. Yes, amen. So when we look at this, saints of God, we are looking at healing and deliverance. And so areas in the soul, and I see where Kelsey's talking about child abuse. I get into this in great detail as it relates to my own personal abuse, not child abuse, but my first ex-husband who was demonically possessed, I was married to for 9 months, so severely abused me and traumatized me that I actually disassociated. Amen, Kelsey. Amen. And y'all listen to the teaching. I don't want y'all to get distracted because I'm going to start looking at your comments and trying to answer them. Listen to the teaching. Amen. But I share in God's Firewall Healing of the Soul series. Get that series. It's on Amazon. And I literally get into the blueprint of man's soul and how you dissociate in different areas of your soul, bringing in the book of Nehemiah. And I show you areas in which processes go through in your soul to establish the name of God. Amen. So let's listen to today's teaching and y'all focus, amen, because it's going to get us off on topic. So let's look at verse 20. This is the emphasis here, right? Scripture says, I have been crucified with Christ. Hallelujah. Do you see the saints of God? In Him, I have shared in His crucifixion. It is no longer I who live, but Christ the Messiah lives in me. And the life I now live in the body, I live by, here it is, saints of God, faith. The life that I live in this vessel, I live by faith. Now remember the teachings that I've been doing, and I've explained that I've gotten into it in Rev 22. In great measure, is on friendship. Faith equals friendship, and faith equals commitment. And so when we're looking at Paul here, describe this new life that he's living, he is depicting, look, I am crucified with Christ Jesus, and I am living in that friendship. It is that friendship in Christ, hallelujah, that I have association, that I'm committed to, And it's that friendship, hallelujah, that strengthens me, that fulfills me with love overflowing, and it lives inside of me. Amen. So let's look at verse 20 again. I have been crucified with Christ. In Him I have shared His crucifixion. It is no longer I who live, but Christ the Messiah, He lives in me. And the life that I now live in the body, I live by faith, in by adherence and reliance on and complete trust in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself up for me. Do you see this, saints of God? Holy Spirit is bringing a greater grace for us to decrease. And you know what this decrease is about? Is about how deep do you want your friendship with Christ to be? Do you see the distortion that the enemy brings? Think about this, saints of God. And it came as we, the church, extracted in the 19th century, we extracted out of the life that Jesus led, we extracted and removed the title name that God gave Him. Yes, that's the title name, Nancy. The Son of God. That's the title name that God gave Him. And I've done these teachings that are on Facebook, and they are on sonship. So in this new book, Rev 22, the aim and the focus begins after the foundation is laid to prepare the watchman. The focus is planted on sonship, because we cannot be in true friendship with God if we do not have that establishment of sonship. So when we look specifically in the area of faith and Paul depicting his faith, what he's really telling you is, listen, I have found the voice and the sound of God, and He is love. That's who He is. He is not fear. He is not dread. He is not punishment. He is love. And how do we know this? The road to Damascus experience. A lot of people look at Isaiah 6 when God's glory came in the temple and the prophet is undone and he's trembling, and the presence of God as the Lord of hosts is present to send Isaiah. Understand that with all of God's apostles and prophets through the Old Testament and even the New Testament, they have an encounter, hallelujah, with the Lord of hosts. And so we see this with Paul. It is no different. It's a mirror image to Isaiah 6. It's the road to Damascus experience. Paul, on the road to Damascus, had a revelation. He thought he knew who God was, right? He thought he knew who God was, but he did not know. And so when we look at this, particularly as it relates to Paul, that is the best analogy we can see, where God just removes and extracts the law that has been a flog to Paul on him, and also in his hand, where he is flogging others with that flog. And he is only able to give out of the resources of his person before the road to Damascus, which is actually in the book of Acts, as we look at scripture, Acts 9. And we see this powerful encounter before this. What was the fruit of Paul? It was murder. It was anger. It was impatience. All of the fruit of the enemy. The fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But when this experience came, a lot of people examined this in Isaiah 6, And they say, you know, God's holiness was so powerful that it just absolutely overcame them. But you have to understand our God because he's multifaceted. And you have to understand that Paul already perceived the Father under the impression of fear and dread. And so that would not totally tilt Paul of seeing only God as someone who had wrath, but Jesus came so that we did not have to be partakers of that wrath, right? Paul needed an encounter that would utterly tilt his mind and would completely erase all that he thought he knew about God. And what was it? It was the encounter of love. We can see this mirror image with Isaiah 6 as the prophet is undone before the glory of God. And he says, woe is me, for I am a man of what? Unclean lips. And I'm among a people of what? Unclean lips. You have to be able to comprehend that in God's holiness is the multifacetedness, the copiousness is actually the better word for that, of his nature. And so you have all of these facets dancing together in this atmosphere that are overwhelming the soul. And within that, the most powerful agent meets Isaiah. And it meets Paul, and it's love. And God's presence of unfailing love that is beyond what we can imagine, it's beyond what we can think, and it shows us that we are undeserving, but although we're undeserving, through Christ Jesus, hallelujah, we've been redeemed, and we're no longer under the law, we're no longer under the curse, but we are under love. Because understand, saints, you have the fruit of your lips. You have the fruit of your lips. And whatever you speak, you're going to be eating. And so the enemy wants to bring fear, dread, and punishment because he wants us to give words to it, to speak it, in order that it come upon us, because we're actually misinterpreting who the Father is. And so when we see Isaiah, he was being prepared to be sent to the nation of Israel. And had he not had this encounter, he would have condemned the remnant. Because the remnant in Isaiah 6:13 were going to look cursed. They were going to be cut down to a stump. And in the prophet's own eyes, if he would have viewed the remnant through his own eyes, he would have thought God's cursed them. God's not blessing them. And he would not understand the sifting of God. And so God had to deal with his prophet so that he would carry his love for Israel. And he would speak to them as the Father would speak to them. That in the midst of their captivity, they were going to find freedom. They were going to be a nation born in a day. And it would be an upper room experience that would be Pentecost. And they would be redeemed. Hallelujah. Israel would be redeemed. This is the grace of a watchman, where a watchman knows the Father's love. So we see this with Paul the Apostle here in Galatians. And he is emphasizing the fact he's had a road to Damascus experience. Hallelujah. And he has been unraveled from the law. It has been removed from his person. And he is bound up in love. And this love is expressed on the cross. Why? Because Jesus says in John 15, no greater love is it than for this, to lay down your life for your brother. Do you see this, saints of God? That was the ultimate demonstration, hallelujah, of love. For God so loved the world that he sent what? His only begotten Son. That's who he sent. Hallelujah. He loved the world. He sent his only begotten Son that whoever believes in him, whoever clings to him, hallelujah, shall be saved. And so as we look at this fast, let's let God cause us in our humility, amen, to show us areas where we have perceived the Father in a wrong perception. Why? Because we're still listening to the lies of the enemy through the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And the volume of it is turned up in the wounds of the souls, and those wounds where healing has not come. That's strongholds. That's 2 Corinthians 10, where we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we're taking all these lofty arguments captive and we're bringing them down unto obedience under Christ Jesus, and it will be fulfilled when that disobedience is under his feet. Amen. And it starts by us choosing to be crucified with Christ. So in this hour, God is specifically showing us areas in our soul that have fear, that have dread, that have punishment. And he is showing us the truth that it's because we have not, 1 John 4:18, we have not matured in love. But guess what, saints of God? As we press into this fast and we start to ask God, God, fill me with love. Drive out fear. Drive out dread. Drive out punishment, God. Let it no longer be a part of me in Jesus' name, in the name of the Son of God. And God will answer you supernaturally because you're seeking, you're asking, you're knocking, and the door will be opened and he will pour out Holy Spirit. And Holy Spirit will send the Father's love, and God's love will drive out fear. I know this particularly, and I'm going to share it before we get to 1 Kings 19, because God wants to encourage you. He wants to edify you. In 2005, when I was leaving the house and going to the gym and had been studying the Word and had been with Rich and reading a book, a Christian author, and just in the presence of the Lord, I left the house and I was going to the gym, which was literally pretty much around the block. It was literally around the block. So I get in my car and I just go right down the street, probably not even 100 feet. And I turn left and I turn left and probably go only another 100 feet. And within going this 100 feet after I turn left, I immediately became so sick. And I just felt like this grossness. I can't explain it. Like a dead animal is the only way I can describe it. Like a dead animal was in my stomach. And just the velocity of its presence inside of me, this is the only way I can describe it, was just experienced throughout my chest and throughout my mind and in my throat. And I was just actually so weak. And I just felt this horrible presence. And I just felt as I was going to die. And so I pulled off the road and I was trying to pick up the phone to call Rich, the flip phone. And my hand got so weak that I could not even call my husband. And this was all beyond my understanding. And I thought I was going to die. I literally thought I was going to die. But all of a sudden, a power came in my belly. And I felt a strength in my inner man. And within just a moment, like a second, there was this glob. And I know this might not sound great to some of you, and I have a gag reflex. Believe me, I have a gag reflex. But a glob came up out of my stomach, up through my chest, and it landed 10 miles an hour in my hand. And it filled my entire palm. And the best depiction I can tell you is it looked like the color of like a jellyfish. It was a glob that big in the size of the palm of my hand. And my first reaction was, what is that? Oh my goodness. And I opened my car door and I flung off my hand. And then I felt the power of Holy Spirit lift me and strengthen me. And I felt like I could run the New York Marathon. And I was like, woo, what just happened? Hallelujah. I feel awesome in Jesus' name. And God said, Robin, I drove out fear. Fear had been in you. It had been a stronghold. And my perfect love came upon you. And it drove that fear out. And I was like, glory to God. So it is literal. And God said, absolutely. And I'm telling you, saints of God, that we serve a mighty God who is able. He can do exceedingly, abundantly, above what you think, according to the power. Woo! Hallelujah. That's an operation inside of you. A lot of people just do Ephesians 3:20, and I used to do that years ago because I taught on it a gazillion times, and it's constantly one of my main scriptures. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above what we think or imagine. And generally, we stop there. But many years ago, God said, nuh-uh, Robin, because after going through law school and studying contracts, I knew that when you have the word contract, when you had and in it, that it meant both one and the other. Amen, Nancy and Margaret, one and the other. Hey, Vicky. And so when we look at this, and scripture says God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above what you think or imagine according to the power. Woo! Hallelujah. That's it. Operation inside of you. And what is that power? Let's go to Ephesians 3:16. What does it say? God strengthen us in our inner man, in our belly. Woo! In our soul. Hallelujah. Which is your second brain in your belly, your heart, and your first brain in your head. Strengthen our inner man with what? The spirit of might. So that what? We can be rooted deeply and grounded securely in what? The love of Christ. Woo! Hallelujah. Friendship with God. Woo! Hallelujah. That will deliver you in Jesus' name. If you want deliverance, you get hungry and you get thirsty for friendship with God, where the law does not bring fear, does not bring dread to you, because you are under, you are rooted in, filled, and overflowing with love. Now let's end here as we look at 1 Kings 19. I pray to God that you all are just overwhelmed with the power of Holy Spirit. And what the Father is revealing in this broadcast, amen. I'm so glad I signed on. And I'm teaching you some of the things I've actually written about in my new book. And so when we look at this particular teaching right here, as it relates to 1 Kings 19, we're going to look at Elijah. And there's a transition in Elijah. And he's having to have that issue of fear and dread in his person addressed, and to encounter God, woo, hallelujah, as the God of love. This love, it is indescribable. It fills, it completes, it makes whole, it restores, it recovers, woo, hallelujah. It's beyond anything of this earth. And this is who Elijah meets. And we find through the torment of the spirit of Jezebel, where Jezebel sends the message. What is the message operative under in Elijah's soul? It's operative under the law. And how do we know this? Because Elijah is afraid. And the law that is operating. Now think about this. Now, God is just brilliant. We know that God gave him instructions about taking care of the prophets of Baal. Right? And so what did Jezebel speak to to make Elijah afraid. She said, this will happen to you tomorrow. I'm going to do the same thing to you tomorrow. Watch out, Elijah. I'm going to do the same thing to you tomorrow. And she's speaking to the issue Satan is to the issue of the law. About what? Murder. Thou shalt not murder. And so the enemy has now twisted everything that Elijah has done for the Lord. And the enemy is screaming in Elijah's head, you've murdered! You've murdered! And so Elijah is running on the issue of fear. Yes, it's fear, Nancy. It's not necessarily just fear of his own life that Jezebel is going to kill him, but it also is a fear where the enemy has put a hook of the law in Elijah's mind saying, you've murdered, you've murdered, you've murdered, you've murdered. And Elijah is running because he's bound up in confusion by listening to the voice of the enemy, taking the word of God and perverting it. Do you see this, saints of God? It is no different than you and I. But let us look at the transaction, the transformation that has to occur in the prophet Elijah. Amen. And so let's look at the place where he is coming out of the cleft of the rock. He's been going to Hebron. So let's look at verse 11. And he said, go out and stand. In fact, let's start in verse 10. I love this. This is such an awesome scene in the Word of God. Let's look at verse 9. There he came to a cave, and he lodged in it. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. And he said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? He replied, I have been very jealous for my God, for the Lord God of hosts. Here it is. For the Israelites have forsaken you. This is the law. Do you hear this speaking? He's jealous, but he's about to find out real jealousy. And this is the teaching that God is bringing to you today. I talk about God's jealousy in my book, At His Feet, about this particular text. But we're going to see it in a different angle for today's teaching, amen, to bring freedom. How many of you want freedom, amen? I want freedom. And he says, I am very jealous. Let me do that again. I am very jealous, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant. They've thrown down your altars. They've killed your prophets with a sword. And I am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And so what is he addressing? He's addressing God through the law. Do you see this, saints of God? So let's go to the next verse. And he said, because now he has to have an encounter with the Lord of hosts through the avenue in that copiousness of who God is, through the avenue of love. So let's look at verse 11. And he said, this is God. And he said, go out and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by. Does this sound familiar? Sounds like Moses. And a great and strong wind rent the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, woo, a sound, woo, here it is, hallelujah, of a gentle, still, small voice. When Elijah heard the voice, woo, hallelujah, he wrapped his face in his mantle, and he went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice. Hallelujah. Now here God's voice is talking again. But this time, hallelujah, it sounds different. Woo! Hallelujah. Because it sounds like love. It sounds like power. It sounds like hope. and he hears the sound of God, and he is filled with strength. And so when he responds, he says, I'm very jealous, but he says it in a different way. He says it with a different meaning because he has been visited. His eyes are open. His ears are open to know God, to know who he is, and to be visited by his love. This, saints of God, is the power of love. God wants to fill you. He wants to deliver you by his love, through his Holy Spirit and the very Word of God. So I speak over you. I take authority over the spirit of fear, over dread, over punishment. And I bind that spirit in Jesus' name. I declare that that root system of dread, fear, and punishment is uprooted like a mulberry tree and cast into the sea in Jesus' name. And I declare those lying serpents that are on your neck with fear, dread, and punishment are lifted off in Jesus' name. Heaviness be lifted off in Jesus' name. And I take the sword of God's word and cut the cords of fear, dread, and punishment and command it loose you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, and to go into the wilderness in Jesus' name. Fear and dread of punishment looses you and go into the wilderness in Jesus' name. And I call in 1 John 4:18, and I declare that perfect love, hallelujah, God's love, woo, in the name of Jesus, by the Lord of hosts in Jesus' name, that comes as a still small voice, hallelujah, to you, that it fills you and it drives out fear. In Jesus' name, where there is no thought of fear nor dread of punishment because of the perfecting of love that you're in of Christ Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Woo! I love you, and I will see you Thursday. And please pray for me to get this book. I have to have it finished by Friday because it's going to be uploaded. No matter what I have it, it's going to be uploaded. I love you. God bless you. And Galatians 2:20 fast in Jesus' name.